So this lesson, we're going to actually start to consider a whole new type of crime that actually we haven't really discussed that much as a kind of on its own, I guess. We've talked about it perhaps in relation to corporate crime and that sort of thing, but actually on its own we've not really addressed, and that is green crime. Now, what we need to do when we talk about green crime is we need to talk about actually the implications of crimes against the environment. What does it mean? How does it actually affect our definition of what makes crime? But also, how can it possibly be affected by things like globalization? How can we explain it? Does it need a separate explanation on its own? But first, let's just look at first how we define some of these terms, but also how it affects our definition of crime itself. Green crime is in many ways what you'd expect it to be. It refers to crimes which are committed against the environment. It can range from individual actions through to actions by businesses, major corporations, and right up to actions by governments or the state. There are a number of high-profile examples of green crime, of course, including the BP oil spill in the Mexico Gulf, or the Union Carbine plant, which I'll get you to research. And these green crimes are actually split into two forms. First is primary green crime, which is crimes which are committed directly against the environment, or acts that cause harm to the environment by your own direct action, such as pollution, animal cruelty, or deforestation. These things have no middleman. They are an immediate and direct harm to the environment and the ecosystem around you. But then there is secondary green crime, which is further crime which grows out of flouting rules related to the environment. For example, this could be violence against environmental groups, such as the French attack on the Greenpeace ship, the Rainbow Warrior. But it's also things like bribery or organised crime to avoid environmental regulations. So I suppose you could summarise it as primary green crime being an actual crime against the environment, secondary green crime being a crime that flouts the rules related to the environment. But an interesting note that we have to consider here is that green crime is often legal. It's often actually totally unprosecuted. There are criminologists known as green criminologists who argue that actually they're not interested in the traditional manner by which we define crime, that it breaks the law. They're more interested in the actual harm that is caused by a green crime. Yes, they'll look at illegal environmental activities such as pollution or breaking laws related to animal cruelty or the protection of wildlife, but they would be also more interested in activities that are actually within the current law, but significantly damage the environment and as a result cause harm, such as very legal logging activity in rainforests and excessive production of plastics. The term green criminology was first coined by M.J. Lynch in 1990, and his fellow green criminologist White in 2008 said that there were two different green harms, anthropocentric harm and ecocentric harm. Anthropocentric harm considers harm to the environment from the perspective of humanity. Pollution is a problem because it damages human water supply, or causes diseases, or causes the sea levels to rise, which means that humans have to move. So anthropocentric harm is harm to the environment as seen by humanity, or as a problem for humans, whereas ecocentric harm does not distinguish between humans and the rest of the ecosystem. It sees harm to the aspect of environment as harm to all of it. Anything which damages the entire ecosystem of Earth damages all of it. Therefore, crimes like animal cruelty or the destruction of habitats are green crimes, regardless of whether or not there is any human costs. So, green criminologists are sometimes known as transgressive criminologists, simply because they just don't buy into the kind of traditional way of measuring what makes a crime. If you just measure crime by what is breaking the law, they argue, then actually you're not really kind of measuring the extent of harm done to people and done to people's ecosystem. You know, for example, if you have a company that legally produces loads of unnecessary plastic and dumps it into the ocean, or indirectly having it end up in the ocean anyway, then actually that's totally legal, and you're letting that go to one side if that's your definition of crime. So transgressive or green criminologists would argue we should define crime by the harm done to someone's environment, and that means that green crime needs to be at the forefront of our agenda. You know, things like global warming, for example, that actually now globalization has made global green crime a huge crisis, you could argue, if that's your point of view. So actually, that's the kind of point of view of green criminologists. But how do we assess that claim? How do we evaluate it? The major problem with the transgressive criminology of green criminologists is that essentially this definition of crime by anything that actually causes harm, then actually the activity that could come under scrutiny by criminologists is almost infinite. Think about it. If we define crime as something which causes harm, then actually the definition of what makes crime becomes so broad as to become meaningless. While Marxists and feminists, for example, have identified problems in the way that we define rule-breaking as some kind of social construct. For example, the Marxists would say that crimes and laws are just the product of the bourgeoisie's system of oppression, but they at least offer some kind of limit as to what can and should be studied. But if you extend the definition of crime to anything which causes harm to the environment, like secondary environmental crime, then actually it just becomes totally empty and meaningless. Not only that, but we also need to factor in that what constitutes harm is subject to basically anyone's political or moral judgment, rather than any kind of objective empirical fact. What one person considers harm, another person may consider completely different. Some will argue that the economic bonuses, for example, that are granted to the communities that deforest, say, parts of the rainforest, far outweigh any of the dangers caused by the deforestation itself. These debates, you can have your own opinion on, but at the end of the day, they are opinion. And if you're basing a whole theory of criminology based on the subjective definition of harm, then you're kind of in the swamp.